Recorded Books Inspirational presents an unabridged recording of A Measure of Mercy by Lauraine Snelling, narrated by Stina Nielsen and directed by Jeffrey Brick. This book is copyrighted 2009 by Lauraine Snelling. This recording is copyrighted 2010 by Recorded Books, producer and publisher of Recorded Books Inspirational, an imprint dedicated to stories of faith and the human spirit. And now, A Measure of Mercy.
Chapter 1. Late June 1903, Blessing, North Dakota. Go or stay? Astrid stared at the daisy in her hand and pulled off two petals. Sitting on the back porch, she was supposed to be hulling strawberries, but somehow that didn't work as well when one had life-altering decisions to make. She pulled another petal, go, and watched it drift down to the second of the three steps. You done with the berries? Her mother, Ingeborg, asked from the other side of the closed screen door. Astrid shook her head. Almost. She laid the daisy down and stood herself up, stretching her clasped hands above her head and twisting first to the left, then to the right. The pull made her long for a good run across the fields. And that made her think of the old swing down by the river, where she and the others used to pump up to the sky, until the day one of the ropes broke and one of the boys landed in the water. From then on, they only used it to swing out over the river and jump in. At least the boys did. The girls weren't allowed. But she and Cousin Sophie had leaped from the rope and never told anyone. Maybe she should ask Sophie for advice. Maybe not. Here, I need a breeze for a while. Ingeborg handed her a tray with a plate of cookies and a glass of lemonade, ice chunks floating in it. Ever since they'd purchased the ice box from Penny's store, the Blessing Mercantile, the new name she'd given it, ice in the drinks was a common event. Astrid set it on the table and sat in the chair to begin hulling. She could smell the fine perfume of strawberry jam cooking. I'm making biscuits for strawberry shortcake for dinner. That will make your father supremely happy. Ingeborg sat down, waving her apron to create a breeze. Mighty still out here. She looked toward the west. Could be rain coming. We sure need it. They picked up their glasses at the same time, and Ingeborg drank a good part of hers. All right. What is wrong? She glanced over at the limp flower now lying on the porch, with several of its petals missing. He loves me not? Astrid made a face. Now who would I be thinking that about? What then? Ingeborg, her braids fading from golden to silvered gilt and wrapped around her head, crown-like, leaned toward her daughter, her voice full of love and concern. Same old thing. Do I stay here or go to Chicago for the surgical training? Ingeborg sighed. I thought God would have made it clear by now, but one thing I've learned through the years, though he seems mighty slow at times, he is never late. Astrid sipped her drink and nibbled on a ginger cookie. These berries are for the shortcake? Yes, so you might as well slice them too. Just us? Since Jonathan Gould was living with them for the summer again, as he learned to farm Dakota style, us included him. I think so. But what's left over we'll make into syrup for swizzles. And pancakes and ice cream and... She smiled at her mother. Strawberries fixed any way were a favorite at the Bjorklunds. Feel that? She tipped her head back to let the breeze whisper her neck. But how do you know more? God doesn't speak out of the bush anymore, or in a thundering cloud. I need to know absolutely. Astrid, all I can tell you is that at the right time, God's time, you will know. She spoke each word precisely, softly, and yet with the conviction of steel holding them together and yet apart. Astrid stared down at the daisy. All life drained out of it, When the time was right, she would know. How many times had she heard her mother speak those words through the years? Her answer was similar when Astrid used to ask why the sky is blue, or how do cows know when it's going to rain, or any number of other questions. God made it so, and so it is. She'd known better than to ask again, at least for a while. Tomorrow I have my big exam with Elizabeth. I'll be praying for you. I know. To think she's putting me in charge of everything at the surgery for the day. I sure hope everyone is healthy around here. Then it wouldn't be much of a test, would it? True. She set her glass back down with a click. I'd better get the berries finished, and then I'm going to weed the garden. Put your sunbonnet on. Astrid kept the groan to herself. She'd let it fall down to her back, like always. Sunbonnets were so hot. No honest breeze could even make it around those wide brims. Another one? Astrid looked up from cleaning the boy's wound. The easy day in surgery was not turning out at all like she had hoped. An emergency. Dr. Elizabeth left the room in a swirl of skirt and apron. Hurry, she spoke firmly. Astrid smiled at her young patient. I'll be right back. She handed a gauze pad to the boy's mother. Hold this on his arm, and I'll come back as soon as I can. Of course. Astrid stepped into the hallway and across to the larger of the two examining rooms. She could hear several voices talking at once. Then a cry saturated with pain caught at her throat. Something bad had happened. As part of her physician exam, this was the day she was responsible for treating all of the patients who came to the clinic. No one had considered a serious accident occurring. She paused in the doorway. A man thrashed on the table while two others fought to hold him down. His teeth were clamped on the piece of wood someone had given him. Yet he still sent one of the men crashing toward the wall. Dr. Elizabeth glanced over her shoulder and nodded toward the other side of the table. She wants me to take care of this. But I'm not ready, fired through her mind. Rather than turn and run like her heart screamed, Astrid stepped up to the blood-splattered table. The younger of the three men pressed a towel against the belly wound, his eyes wide as they darted from Dr. Elizabeth to Astrid. Astrid turned to the pan to scrub her hands. What happened? He fell off the wagon onto a pitchfork that was stuck in the ground. The handle tore halfway through him. Her heart hammering as if seeking exit, Astrid let the water run down her raised arms and took her place on the other side of the table. What would you do first? Dr. Elizabeth asked. How could she be so calm? Astrid sucked in a deep breath of air, heavy with the scent of blood and something worse. We can tell he's breathing all right, so settle him down with chloroform? The words flowed in spite of her panic. So we can do a thorough examination. Clear the clothing away from the site of the wound and check for other injuries. Right. Elizabeth lifted the towel just enough to look at the wound and laid it back down. Astrid reached in the cabinet for the chloroform bottle, poured a few drops on a cloth, and moving swiftly, held it above the man's mouth so it didn't burn his skin. He gasped, his face relaxed, and his terrified eyes closed. Thank you. Now, if one of you gentlemen would take her place at his head and hold that bottle, I will tell you when to add a few more drops so we can keep him sedated.
I will.
The older man took Astrid's place.
This is my eldest son, Vernon. Doctor, please, I know this is bad. Help God work a miracle.
Astrid heard a slight German accent in his plea.
We'll do our best.
Elizabeth felt beneath the patient. You said the handle went halfway through.
Yes. Thank God it didn't go all the way. His legs work, as you saw. Arms, too. But his insides are a mess.
Elizabeth looked to the younger man standing at her shoulder. If you'd go find my housekeeper and ask her to come in here, please. Her name is Thelma, and she's most likely in the kitchen. As he left, she turned to Astrid. Go out and tell those waiting that we will be busy for some time. Astrid flew out of the room, popped into the other examining room where she had been before, and told the boy's mother that they had an emergency and she'd get back when she could. Several in the waiting room stood when they heard and said they'd come back another time. Astrid lifted down the earpiece on the telephone and asked the operator to ring the Bjorklund farm. What's wrong? Gerald Balders, the daytime switchboard operator, asked as he put the call through.
A terrible accident. Please call Pastor Solberg. We're going to need all the help we can get.
She heard the phone ringing.
Hello?
Astrid calmed a little at the sound of her mother's voice.
Moore, come quickly. We need help. Bring your bag.
I will.
Astrid hung up and returned to the examination room. Now quiet, but for the stentorian breathing of the man on the table. Thelma was helping cut away the man's shirt, her face even more wrinkled than normal.
I called Moore,
Astrid said. Good, I figured you would. The bleeding has slowed. Thelma, bring us a bucket of hot water and lay the instruments in the carbolic acid. She looked to Astrid. Put on a surgical apron and scrub again.
Sir, what is your name?
Baxter. We work on the Bonanza farm across the river.
Mr. Baxter, watch your son closely, and if he starts to blink or flinch, drip a couple more drops on the cloth.
Yes, ma'am. You need my other boy?
We might.
She addressed the young man, who was once again at her shoulder. Would you please wait in the hall? And if you are praying, folk, please do so. We need the Almighty's help here. She closed her eyes for a moment. After tying a kerchief over her hair, the color of aged honey, and donning the straight surgery apron that covered her from neck to ankle, Astrid lifted the instruments out of the disinfectant. She sucked in a deep breath as the odors coming from the wound made her throat start to close, but kept moving. With the blood-soaked towel out of the way, the enormity of the wound made her glance up at Elizabeth, who was focused on the task before them. Astrid swallowed her question and began digging out debris. Pieces of cloth, bits of wood, and bone, where a rib had broken off.
Please, Moore, get here soon.
Thelma kept handing the two women sterile cloths and mopping up blood and body fluids, along with the sweat from their foreheads. When Astrid saw the tear in the intestine, she wanted to cry. How would they ever fight off the infection that would cause? She set her sorrow aside and slid her hand into the cavity to feel for more debris. The handle bypassed the major arteries, she reported. Otherwise, he would have never made it this long. Good girl, Dr. Elizabeth nodded. Can you detect any more foreign substances?
Not big enough that I can find. How it missed his heart and lungs, I'll never know.
Mostly stomach and intestine damage. We can suture those and then wash as much out as we can.
Will we leave a drain in?
Yes, but take out as much damaged tissue as possible. You start with suturing the stomach wall, and I'll do the intestine. Thelma, we'll need several of the bulb syringes. And ask that young man out there to make sure there's water boiling. We're going to need more.
How can I help?
Ingeborg stepped through the door.
Thank God you're here.
Elizabeth quickly raised her eyes toward her mother-in-law. Pray while you clean and sterilize the instruments. If only we had a real operating room. Scrub up, too, in case we need another pair of hands.
I've been praying. Gerald put out the call for prayer.
Astrid glanced at her mother. Could you please get me a glass of water?
Me too, Elizabeth said.
How about you, Mr. Baxter?
Please.
He nodded.
I just added 3 more drops.
Oh, and please go finish bandaging that boy in the other room. His mother must think we've forgotten about him.
I will.
Ingeborg closed the door carefully behind her. Astrid tied off another stitch and cut the thread.
His stomach is going to be lots smaller. So much of the tissue is damaged.
She wiped the sweat from her forehead with the back of her hand. Trickles ran down her spine.
They might have been at this for hours. She couldn't tell.
She picked up another needle that Thelma had prepared and started again.
There, last one I can find, Elizabeth said as she tied off a small bleeder sometime later. Let's irrigate.
Having just returned, Ingeborg put the stethoscope in her ears and listened to the man's chest.
His heartbeat is slow but steady. Lungs sound clear.
That is truly miraculous.
Astrid glanced up at Mr. Baxter to see a tear leaking down his cheek.
Your son is very strong, but he's not out of the woods yet. Not at all, Elizabeth warned.
I know, but thanks to you he has a chance. I know about belly wounds. I've seen men die from them.
Please, God, let this be one who makes it, Ingeborg said.
Astrid removed the last pad and dropped it into the bucket with the others.
Ready to close?
At Elizabeth's nod, Astrid looked to her mother.
You want to help?
Of course.
The three of them worked together as if they were quilting. They closed the peritoneum, repaired the damaged muscles, and finally stitched the layers of skin.
He looks like a patchwork,
Ingeborg said as she tied off her final stitch.
Please, Heavenly Father, we have done our best. We thank you for giving this man life and strength. And we leave him in your mighty hands. Thank you for the wisdom you have given here and for the love you so freely spread on all of us. In your son's name, we pray.
The others joined her on the Amen, along with another male voice.
Ah, good. You're here, John.
The older woman smiled at their pastor, John Solberg.
I've been out here praying for what seems like hours.
That's because it has been hours.
Elizabeth tipped her head back, stretching muscles too long tense.
Mr. Baxter, you did a fine job as our anesthesiologist. You can let your son become more alert now. The pain is going to be atrocious, so we will keep him sedated as much as possible for the first couple of days.
She held a syringe filled with morphine. This will help with the pain, she said, as she inserted the medicine into his buttock.
You will keep him here?
Mr. Baxter looked around.
Where?
We have rooms for such as this. Elizabeth checked the patient's pulse.
Where do you want us to put him?
Waiting in the doorway, Torlif Bjorklund looked at his wife.
Let's use the bigger room.
Mr. Baxter, my husband and our pastor are used to moving patients. They will show you how to assist them. Astrid watched their patient. First his eyelids fluttered, and then he grimaced.
We better move him quickly. He's coming around.
The women stepped out of the room to give the men the space to do their job.
This certainly shows our need of a surgical room with decent lighting and enough room to move about.
Astrid, you passed today's examination with flying colors. Even without formal surgical training, I'd rather have you assisting me than any other doctor I know.
It seemed as if the two of you could read each other's minds. You worked so smoothly together.
Ingeborg leaned against the wall.
Astrid, how did you know what to do?
I guess I've memorized the pictures in Grey's Anatomy, but I can sure see the value of working on a real body.
Now that it was over, Astrid realized that, though physically she was tired, her mind was racing, trying to process all the new information the surgery had given her.
So, Has this convinced you to go to Chicago?
Astrid thought for a moment. Elizabeth had been insisting she go for more formal instruction at the Alfred Morgenstein Hospital for Women and Children. Since she already had so much practical experience helping at the surgery in Blessing, she would only need to go for the surgical training, if she could pass the tests on all the other required classes first. But Chicago was so far away. Yet working with Dr. Althea Morgenstein, Elizabeth's own mentor, would be invaluable. Astrid knew her sister-in-law had taken her on with this plan in mind. She also knew Elizabeth would take it personally if Astrid didn't pass the rigorous examinations Dr. Morgenstein required. Astrid glanced at her mother and nodded, "Yes, I am certain." Was that a whisper she'd heard, or had God really spoken? Or just sent this test for her? Ingeborg blinked at the moisture gathering in her eyes and returned the nod. The trio followed the men into the larger of the rooms with beds on the first floor, the one they'd designated as the recovery room, and checked to make sure there was no blood leaking. When the young man groaned, his father took his hand.
"You rest easy, Vernon. The doctors are doing their best for you."
"He thinks I'm a real doctor," Astrid realized. The thought made her smile inside. "Do you want me to take the first shift?"
"No, I will."
Ingeborg took her place in the chair.
"You too, go get something to eat and rest a bit. There are more people in the waiting room, but I told them it would be some time yet."
Astrid and Elizabeth swapped smiles. Doctors or not, sometimes mothers still took charge.
"Thank you, we will, after we clean up. Oh, and Thelma said to tell you she'd take care of the surgery. The soup is simmering on the stove and the coffee is hot. Do you mind if I stay here for a while?"
Mr. Baxter asked. "You stay as long as you want. Have you had dinner?"
"No. We'll bring you a tray." "Thank you, but you don't need to do that. I mean,"
he lowered his eyes at the look Elizabeth sent his way,
"I'd be obliged."
Astrid and Elizabeth found Torlif and Pastor Solberg in the kitchen.
"You want coffee?"
"We've not had dinner either," Torlif said.
"You want company?"
Elizabeth nodded. "Let's eat out on the porch, where it's cooler." Fresh rolls waited on the counter in the cheerful kitchen, which was really Thelma's domain. She had geraniums blooming in the east window, white curtains with red trim, and braided rugs in front of the stove and the sink. The cushions on the oak chairs matched the red and white print of the tablecloth.
"Oh, this smells so good."
Astrid inhaled the aroma of freshly baked rolls. Operating rooms smell even worse than the milking barn in winter. She stopped at the sink, took off her blood-stained operating apron, dropped it in the tub of water set for soaking, and began scrubbing her arms and hands.
"Scrub before we operate and wash up afterward."
"That young man needs a real scrubbing too." Torlif took a platter of sliced meat and cheese from the icebox, along with a bowl of freshly washed lettuce leaves, and set them on a tray. "That can be done later." Astrid stepped back from the sink so Elizabeth could wash up. She dried her hands and arms and used the towel to wipe her forehead and neck. Taking bowls down from the cupboard, she dished up the soup and handed the full bowls to Torlif to set on the tray. When they were all seated around the table on the porch, they bowed their heads and let peace flow around them.
"Heavenly Father, thank you for the gifts of healing you displayed here today," the pastor began. "Thank you for willing hearts as we wait for you to finish what has begun. Thank you for the food before us, for this moment of rest, and, Lord God, whatever happens, we will give you all the glory. In your Son's precious name, amen."
"Thank you. I cannot begin to tell you how much it means to me to know that you are out in that hall
praying while we work on people like this one today. Between you and Ingeborg, you keep us sane.
Elizabeth's lips curved in a deep smile. Pastor Solberg smiled and nodded.
My privilege. So, what is your prognosis on this case?
We've done what we can. Most people would say this one is impossible. Torleif took his wife's hand.
But, as Moore reminded me, with God, all things are possible. And we have seen him do the impossible before.
That we have. Elizabeth glanced over at Astrid. Are you all right?
I don't know. A wave of tiredness just rolled over me. I can hardly pick up my spoon.
That's not surprising. Just make yourself eat and drink plenty of lemonade. It'll pass. Elizabeth did as she'd told Astrid. She turned to Torleif.
What did you do with Inga?
She's out at Andrew's playing with Carl. I took her there when I saw the man in the wagon. I knew you would be busy, and I didn't want her to see such carnage.
Thank you. Astrid drank half the glass of lemonade and buttered a roll, putting slices of meat and cheese and a leaf of lettuce on it. Her feet were aching, her back was whining, and her hands were shaking. Her eyes burned as if she had been crying, or would be shortly. Taking a bite of her roll, she ordered herself to chew.
Elizabeth was eating her roll and laughed at something Torleif said. Pastor Solberg nodded and joined in the laughter. All Astrid wanted to do was throw up what little she had eaten and cry herself to sleep. She'd made it through the worst surgery of her life. What was wrong with her now?
Chapter 2. Ingeborg checked Vernon's pulse, slow but steady. Amazed that he was doing this well after the surgery he'd been through, she sat down in the chair and picked up her prayers again. They felt tangible, like something she could hold in her hands. She closed her eyes, the idea of hands continuing like a gentle stream flowing through her mind. Only instead of her own hands, now she pictured God's hands. Mighty and yet tender, holding this young man securely in his palm, his fingers gently stroking the inert body.
Thank you, Father. You bid us come to you, to bring you the broken of body and heart. Thank you that you promise to heal, to restore, to comfort. I ask peace for this child of yours, peace in his body and in his mind. Let him feel your presence, your great love. Father, I praise you and thank you for your never-ending love and mercy. You know all things, and you know his needs far better than I do. I thank you that we can trust you to do the very best.
She leaned back in the chair, her praises continuing with each breath, each beat of her heart.
Please protect him from the infection that lurks from all the debris we couldn't find.
She laid the back of her hand against his cheek and forehead. Still cool.
Thank you, Father.
Dr. Elizabeth stopped in the doorway. How is he?
Vernon is one strong young man. He's holding his own.
Call me if you see any change.
I will. You look tired.
Surgery like that takes every ounce of energy and skill. Thank you for your prayers, both for him and for us.
God is in control.
I know. Thank you for the reminder. Elizabeth brushed her hand over her forehead.
Can you lie down for a bit?
Ingeborg asked, watching her daughter-in-law's face.
I just sent Astrid up to lie down instead. She got a bit worn out. Not unusual for what she's been through. I remember reacting much the same.
One time I fainted. Any surgery is grueling, but this was beyond anything even I've ever done.
I'm not surprised. This was her first surgery inside a body, wasn't it?
Elizabeth nodded.
She's stitched up many superficial wounds, set bones, and birthed babies. But having your hands inside the body of a living person is a whole different matter. I was proud at her willingness to put aside her discomfort and concentrate only on what needed doing. Elizabeth chuckled. And she is just as amazed, I think. Ingeborg sensed her patient moving before he actually opened his eyes.
Be still, Vernon. You are here at the doctor's. Your father went home to bring your mother in. All will be well.
Elizabeth crossed the room and stopped by the other side of the bed, picking up his hand. We're keeping you sedated so the pain will not be as severe. If you can understand me, please squeeze my hand. She smiled at the light pressure from his fingers.
Good.
Go back to sleep now. You're in God's mighty hands. He blinked, then closed his eyes and drifted off again.
Thank you, Father, that Elizabeth is acknowledging you more and more. Thank you. Thank you.
Ingeborg's mind filled with songs of praise and thanksgiving, lifting her spirit as well as her smile. Elizabeth glanced over at her.
What? I'm just thanking God for you and for all this that has happened. God is so merciful.
Right now, I need his strength along with the mercy and grace.
You have it.
Ingeborg smiled at her. How do you know that?
Because I asked, and you asked, and he says, where two or three are gathered and agree, he will do it. Thank you both.
Elizabeth drew in a deep breath. I think I'll walk outside a couple of minutes before I go back to my waiting patients.
Good idea. Fresh air is another of his gifts.
Elizabeth paused before she went out the door.
How is Håkon? Stronger all the time. I can tell a difference in the strength between his two hands, but he says he can milk as well as he used to. Milking cows is good therapy for hands and arms.
Good. Elizabeth yawned. I'll be back in a minute or two.
We never have enough time to visit, it seems.
Ingeborg's mind flitted to her strawberry patch. Next week, she'd have the final picking. The season was early this year. They usually had strawberries in time for the 4th of July. She'd just slipped back into praying when Thelma entered the room with a cup and spoon on a tray.
I chipped some ice for the young man. A spoonful, whenever he comes to, will do. Thank you. I was about to come and get some for him to suck on.
Thelma nodded.
I'll bring more later.
She set her tray on the table next to Ingeborg.
Can I bring you something cold to drink? That would be lovely, but I can come and get it.
You sit there and put your feet up. She scooted the footstool over in front of Ingeborg. Do you have your knitting?
No, I left in too much of a hurry to grab it. I'm making a dress for Inga. You could hem it if you like. I'd love to, manga tak.
Sewing for her little granddaughter and namesake always lightened Ingeborg's heart. The young man groaned, and his fingers twitched on the sheet that covered him. Ingeborg let the songs in her mind murmur aloud, and watched as the lines in his face smoothed out. She felt his cheek again, still cool. Astrid, after tying on a fresh white apron that covered her from shoulder to ankle, stopped in the doorway.
Singing him to sleep?
It seems to help. Did you sleep?
Like a cat in the sunshine.
She stretched and yawned.
Did Elizabeth mention that I got so shaky I could hardly stand?
That isn't surprising. The wonderful thing is that you were able to do what was needed. I've seen big men faint from far less. Elizabeth has told stories of nurses and doctors in training fainting in surgeries or having to leave because they were vomiting.
The smell was horrible.
Astrid shivered a little.
Worse, even, than when we burned the cattle.
Because of the damaged intestines. But you persevered.
You think helping butcher animals and chickens made me tougher?
Probably.
Being out in the open air helps blow the stench away, not like in that small room. Ingeborg picked up the cup and held a chip of ice to Vernon's lips.
Try this,
she said softly, and smiled as he did so. I need to help Elizabeth with the other patients. I'll come back later so you can go home. Ingeborg nodded and spooned another small chip into their patient's mouth. Noise in the hallway caught her attention a bit later. A man's voice first, and then a woman's.
My son. I want to see my son.
The mother's anguish swirled into the room ahead of a rounded woman with graying hair knotted in a bun. The lines in her face that bespoke hard work now slashed deeper with fear. Ingeborg stood and motioned to her chair.
You sit here so you can be near him.
Mrs. Bjorklund, this is my wife, Vilma. We came back as soon as we could.
Mr. Baxter clutched his hat to his chest and stared down at his boy.
He's still alive.
Yes, and he swallowed some ice bits. It's there in the cup. He can have some every few minutes as long as he can swallow and keep it down.
The mother's tears dripped onto her son's hand as she clutched it to her cheek. She spoke in tear-seasoned German, but the tone sounded only of love. Vernon's eyes fluttered open, and he stared into his mother's face, then turned slightly to look to his father. The faintest of nods welcomed their presence before he drifted off again.
Can I get you anything? Something cool to drink?
Ingeborg asked.
Mr. Baxter shook his head. Thank you. Perhaps later. I'll be back in a while. Call if there is any change or you need anything. The necessary is right down the hall.
Not outside?
No. There is running water to wash with, too. We all wash our hands to try to keep infection down. I can show you how to use it.
Yeah, that would be good.
Mr. Baxter followed her from the room and down the hall.
This is most amazing.
I know.
Ingeborg opened the door. She turned the handles on the faucets, pulled the chain above the commode, and showed him the bar of soap and the hand towels.
Please wash, and then show your wife how this works. We scrub our hands with brushes like the one there.
She pointed to a brush on a glass shelf above the sink.
Please, Lord, let him not be offended.
Danke.
He spoke his thanks with a slight bow, a look of amazement etched on his face. Ingeborg headed for the kitchen and a cup of much-needed coffee.
You go sit on the porch, where there's a bit of breeze. I will bring the coffee.
Thelma paused.
And the dress.
Ingeborg nodded, and out on the porch, she sank into a rocking chair with thick red plaid cushions. A breeze lifted the tendrils of hair that had loosened themselves from the braids fashioned in a crown framing her face and neck. She let her head rest against the back of the chair and reveled in the cool air on her skin. A robin sang from the elm tree just off the porch. Swallows dipped and darted after bugs and brought daubs of mud to their houses in the eaves of the porch. Thelma set a tray on the table and the dress on a chair beside Ingeborg. Then, with a smile, she returned back inside the house. A plate of molasses cookies sat between a cup of coffee and a glass of lemonade. She started with the lemonade, holding the cold glass against her forehead and cheeks. Inga's black and white cat mounted the steps and rubbed against her skirt, eyeing the birds as she mewed to be picked up. All right, come ahead. Ingeborg set her glass back on the tray and patted her knees. The cat didn't need a second invitation and leaped into her lap, bumping her head under Ingeborg's chin before turning around, kneading with her front paws and curling in a circle. Ingeborg stroked the cat, enjoying the soft fur and the purring motor that started up with the first stroke. Smiling, She reached for the cup of coffee and a cookie.
Now, if this isn't the life, sitting here in the middle of the afternoon and ignoring all the work that needs doing.
She eyed the pinafore with ruffles along the crossed straps and ties for the back of the gathered skirt. She knew the pink and white checks of gingham would delight her granddaughter. When she finished the cookie and the cup was only half full, she picked up the dress, along with the threaded needle, and blind-stitched the hem. The cat leaped lightly to the wide board that formed the ledge on the porch railing and prowled after the birds, the tip of her tail twitching as she melted into a crouch. Ingeborg watched the cat between thrusts of the needle.
You better not let Inge see you hunting so close to the house.
So, Moore, who are you talking to now? Torlif pushed open the gate and strolled up the walk.
The cat.
I see. Did Mr. and Mrs. Baxter arrive?
Yes. They are sitting with their son, so I came out here. You want some coffee or lemonade?
You sit still, I'll get it, Torlif said when she started to get up. For a change, Ingeborg settled back. She started to scold herself for being lazy, but instead shrugged and chose to enjoy the moment of ease. Thelma met him at the door with a duplicate tray of the one she'd brought Ingeborg.
You make sure your mother sits a while longer.
Look who's talking.
Be that as it may, I wasn't working that surgery like they were and taking care of the young man.
She raised her voice.
I took more ice chips in. Taking care of her son gives his mother something to do with her hands.
Manga tak, Thelma. You're so wise. What would we do without you? A snort echoed the closing of the screen door. Torlif sat down in the other rocker.
Well, the paper is ready to send out. Samuel is taking it around town.
He laid a copy on the table.
I brought you yours.
Ingeborg picked up the latest edition, smiling all the while.
Håkon will be happy to get this. He always looks forward to your paper arriving.
He used to get the Grand Forks paper, too. Doesn't he any longer?
He let his subscription lapse after the apoplexy. I should probably start it again.
My interview with Keith, who runs the coal mine, is on the front page. I'm thinking Farr might be interested in that. Perhaps we might want to invest in that venture, since it looks like a real boon to North Dakota.
He shot his mother a questioning glance.
Not that we've recovered all the way from the hoof and mouth yet, but our bank has some money to invest. I know you'd rather buy more cows, but you and Farr talk it over.
Torlif drained the glass of lemonade.
I'll go get Inga in a bit.
Why not let her stay a while with Andrew and Ellie? She and Carl always have a great time. After all, cousins need time to play together, too.
I'm not sure Ellie would agree with you. I think Inga gets Carl into all kinds of trouble.
Like making mud pies in the rain barrel.
And putting a chair up so they could climb into the apple tree.
Torlif shook his head.
Andrew thought it was funny, but Ellie was sure they were going to fall and break their necks.
Dressing the runt pig in baby clothes, they took off the clothesline.
Ingeborg grinned at her son and shook her head.
She reminds me of Astrid when she was little.
Astrid didn't get into everything like Inga does.
We were all working so hard that we didn't have time to watch her closely, so perhaps we didn't see some of the things she did. Besides, she had the twins to play with, and she and Sophie spent a lot of time being careful to watch out for Grace. Sophie was the one who thought up the antics.
And she still does. Wait until you hear her plans for the 4th of July celebration.
They heard a buggy pull sharply to a stop on the other side of the house. Someone else was in trouble. Andrew's voice brought her to her feet.
Moore, come help!
Chapter 3.
What happened?
Astrid met them all at the door of the surgery after hearing Andrew's voice.
I think his arm is broken.
Andrew held his son in his arms.
He fell off the ladder going up into the haymow.
Astrid touched the little boy's shoulder and arm that were held tight against his body by a tied-in-place flour sack dish towel.
The hay mow?
I told them to stay out of the barn.
Kitties!
The word was barely discernible between sobs. Her nephew's round, pale face tore at her heart. Come this way and we'll see what to do. Astrid ushered them toward the small examining room.
What kitties, Carl?
There are kittens in the hay mow. Andrew's voice deepened. We found them back in a corner when we were cleaning out the last of the old hay to get ready for the barn dance Saturday night.
And Inga wanted to see them and dragged Carl along?
Grandma Ingeborg pursed her lips and shook her head. That's about it, her younger son agreed.
Where's Maydell?
Maydell Gamble was visiting with Ellie again, now that Dorothy was doing better.
I thought she was keeping an eye on Carl and Inga.
Andrew shrugged.
That seems to be a bit of a mystery.
Lay him down there. Astrid pointed at the table in the middle of the room. She thought back to her last conversation, when Maydell admitted she'd mostly been helping Dorothy with her children because she was hoping to see more of Gus Bard. But as soon as she'd shown up, he kept away. Usually Maydell's flightiness didn't ruffle her, but at the moment, she could think of several things she'd like to do to Maydell. None of them comfortable. When Andrew tried to lay his son down, Carl screamed and clung to his father with his unbound arm. Ingeborg leaned over his small body and stroked his face, humming one of his favorite songs.
All right, Andrew, you sit on that chair and hold him.
Astrid pointed to a ladder-back chair next to the wall.
Or do you want Moore to hold him?
Shaking his head, Andrew sat down, holding Carl on his left knee so the wounded arm could be examined. Astrid leaned over and whispered in Carl's ear.
You are Tante Astrid's big boy, aren't you?
He nodded and tried to sniff back the tears, then buried his face in his father's shoulder.
Carl, I need to find out what's wrong with your arm. I'm going to give you something to drink. So you feel better.
Andrew stared at his sister, his face pale.
Don't worry, it'll make him sleepy, and then we can help him more easily.
She poured a bit of laudanum into a cup and added honey and water, then stirred it.
Here you go, Carl.
She held it to his mouth, and after giving her a dubious look, he took a sip, then drank the rest.
Honey can do all kinds of good things.
You three wait here while I go find Tante Elizabeth. As soon as she stepped out of the room, her mind flew back to the young man down the hall.
How was he?
She peeked in the door to see his mother and father on either side of the bed, Vernon sound asleep.
What a day this had been.
And it was only mid-afternoon. Leaving that room, she knocked on the closed door of the large examining room, obeying the command to come in.
What do you think this is?
Dr. Elizabeth asked her immediately, pointing to two young girls who were covered in suppurating sores. The mother looked from Astrid to Elizabeth, then closed her mouth against what she'd started to say. Astrid studied them without touching their skin.
Looks like poison ivy to me.
And what do you recommend?
Baths in warm water with finely ground oatmeal. Apply honey to the sores. Leave the skin uncovered as much as possible so the air can dry the discharge. She turned to the mother. Do you have rolled oats or plain oats at home to run through the coffee grinder? At her nod, she continued. That will help the itching. If you have some comfrey, grind that and make a paste to apply.
I told them to stay out of the woods, but they had to learn the hard way.
Do you know what poison ivy looks like?
Astrid asked the two weepy girls.
We do now.
The girls looked at each other, then at Astrid.
It was so pretty. We made chains out of it to wear in our hair.
I see, Astrid smiled at the mother. Let us know how this goes. There are some other things we can try if need be. Soak all their clothes and bedding in hot soapy water. Anything they have touched, wash with soapy water.
They are highly contagious.
Thank you, doctors.
The mother nodded to both Elizabeth and Astrid and herded the girls ahead of her out of the room. Astrid had a strong feeling those two girls were in for more punishment than just how miserable they felt.
You passed that one with flying colors.
I'll get Thelma in here to scrub with carbolic acid. Let's go wash ourselves. That was the worst case I've ever seen.
Are they new to the area?
Come from the Minnesota side, like the Baxters. Good thing we have that bridge across the river now. The family moved here from someplace back east. The two joined at the basin and scrubbed hands and arms, then took off their aprons.
Just in case, Elizabeth added.
Astrid told her about Carl while they tied clean aprons on and entered the examining room. Carl lay sound asleep on the table, Andrew and Ingeborg standing on either side of him.
Good, that's what I hoped would happen.
Astrid smiled at her brother.
Did you try to set it?
No. That's what we have doctors for nowadays.
You can work with animals but not humans, is that it? Astrid teased her brother.
That's right, especially not my son.
With gentle fingers, Astrid probed the arm, which was already swollen and hot. The break was halfway between the wrist and elbow.
You hold Carl, and we'll do the traction.
Elizabeth nodded.
I'll take the wrist. Be ready for him to flail.
Andrew pressed against his son's shoulders with both hands.
No, you lie across his body, too. This is going to hurt.
Andrew gave her a funny look, but did as she said.
On three.
Astrid gripped the boy's elbow and upper arm to steady it when Elizabeth pulled.
One, two, three.
Elizabeth pulled. Carl let out a shriek, bucked, and nearly threw his father off. But the bone clicked back in place.
I'll go get the ice.
Elizabeth left the room while Astrid took a flat piece of wood with rounded edges from a shelf and began wrapping it in soft cotton. She laid it next to the arm, wrapped it in place, and folded a square of cloth into a triangle for a sling. When Elizabeth returned with small chunks of ice, they wrapped the ice around the boy's arm and tied the sling in place. Sitting in the chair and holding his still son, who was once again asleep, Andrew nodded.
You two work well together.
Thank you. I sure hope this is the last one of the day. You should have seen the cases of poison ivy we just took care of. My word, what a mess.
Astrid studied her nephew, his long eyelashes feathering his round cheeks.
I'll send some laudanum home with you. I think when he wakes up, we should just wrap his arm to his body like you did to bring him in. Best for a little one like him.
How's Vernon?
You know him?
I'd met him before. You think he'll make it?
I sure am praying so. All of us are.
She shuddered.
That was the most awful.
She blew out a breath.
Why don't you take Moore home with you? She can take care of Carl. Both of them can use some rocking. And she can pray just as well there as here.
I will. Tomorrow we're stringing more phone lines. I am now more convinced than ever how valuable that newfangled instrument is.
That's it for the day,
Elizabeth said, as they watched Andrew carry his son back to the buggy and help Ingeborg settle the child in her lap.
Other than Vernon,
Astrid leaned against the wall.
Didn't I hear his father leave a while ago?
He had to go home to do chores.
Elizabeth sank into a chair.
My daughter did it this time.
Probably won't be the last.
Poor little Carl. I should send Torlif out to get her.
No. Let her help entertain Carl. She'll learn more that way. After all,
you know it wasn't deliberate.
Her disobeying Andrew like that was. He told her not to go to the barn.
Maybe. Maybe he only told Carl and he didn't share the information.
Astrid thought
to the times she'd been in trouble when younger. While she knew Inga deserved a punishment, she still wanted to protect her. As her far had said more than once, Inga could charm the birds out of the trees, let alone her little cousin, who did his best to keep up with her. Sometimes she forgot how young the two really were, the way Inga could interpret for Carl. She'd been talking since she was barely a year and a half. Her far said she was born talking. Dr. Elizabeth dug her fists into her lower back and the aching muscles. This has been some day. How do you feel about all the cases you took care of today? Are you saying that you will still call this part of my final examination? Yes, and you did remarkably well. Even though I overreacted? I don't think a doctor is supposed to fall apart. But that was afterward, and it was due to the adrenaline. Don't be so critical of yourself. I will always feel more secure when you are standing with me in a crisis. Astrid stared at her for a long moment. Do you feel insecure at times? Of course. You mean that never goes away? Elizabeth chuckled at the look of consternation on Astrid's face. Your mother would say that's what forces us to depend on our Heavenly Father, and that's a good thing. Now, let's think about the schedule tonight for Mr. Baxter. I want his mother to sleep too, so let's go talk with her. Do you speak German? A bit. When the two of them entered the sick room, Mrs. Baxter started from a half doze.
Sprechen Sie Englisch?
Elizabeth asked.
Ein bisschen.
The woman held her fingers close together to signal a bit. Over the next few minutes, Astrid watched and listened as the two tried to communicate. The agreement came when Elizabeth convinced the woman that among the four of them, including Mr. Baxter, if he was able to return, they could all take turns caring for her son, and that eating and sleeping were necessary for her, too. She brushed tears from her eyes and clutched Elizabeth's hand.
Danke schön.
Even Astrid knew that meant thank you very much.
We could call on the Geddix for translation if Mr. Baxter can't be here, she said as soon as the idea popped into her head.
That's a great idea, Elizabeth said with a nod. They don't have a telephone yet, do they? Astrid shrugged. I'll call and ask Gerald in the morning. All was going according to plan during the night until Astrid came on duty at 3 o'clock. When Vernon shifted restlessly, she administered more morphine, but touching his skin made her heart sink. He was hot. Infection must be setting in. Much to the consternation of his father, who was watching over him at the time, she pulled back the covers and opened the window. We have to cool him off.
But he was shivering and cold, so I covered him.
I know. That is the way of this. You start sponging his face and neck, and I'll go soak a sheet in cold water. When she came back, the mister was doing as she'd said. But when she started to remove the sheet, he grabbed the edge.
Nein. This is not proper.
Astrid stared at him. What did proper matter at a time like this?
But I'm a doctor. You are a young woman. I will change the sheets.
He took the wet bundle from her and waited. Astrid shook her head.
Before you put the sheets on him, lay a towel across his...
She sought the best word so as not to offend.
Below his waist.
She gestured at the same time.
I will do that.
He waited for her to leave the room.
Who does he think worked on that young man's body yesterday?
She murmured as she leaned against the hall wall. An outside door opened and Pastor Solberg entered.
How is he?
How do you always know when to come?
He shrugged.
I guess God tells me. But we all know these next hours are when life ebbs the lowest. Your mother and I have spent many of these dark hours of the morning praying and pleading for God to heal, to bring the patients through this time.
He paused.
Why are you in the hall?
His father wouldn't allow me to change the sheets. Said it was not proper.
John Solberg stared at his feet, trying to hide his grin.
I have a feeling you will hear this often in the years ahead. Lovely young women, especially unmarried ones, are not easily perceived as doctors.
She rolled her eyes.
Thank you for the compliment, but he's going to have to get used to my being here. Vernon, Mr. Baxter, is running a fever.
That was to be expected, considering what he's been through.
So, now, we do all we can and trust God to do the rest.
I'll go bring a tub of water here to make it easier.
Let me do that. You go check on your patient.
Astrid nodded and knocked on the door.
Come in.
Mr. Baxter finished laying a wet towel across his son's forehead. Astrid glanced up to see that the window was closed again. Surely this man knew better than to keep a sick room closed up. But then, why should he? So many people still believed that fresh air brought in the vapors, that frequent bathing weakened the body. After all the old wives' tales she had read in her medical studying, she was grateful that new studies had proven so many of them wrong.
She crossed to open the window. Please, the fresh air will help us cool him. And if he gets cold, which would be a blessing right now, we will close it and add covers.
The man sighed and nodded.
I suppose you know best.
Thank you.
Astrid laid the back of her hand against the young man's cheek. Cooler, but still hot. She felt the sheet, and wherever it touched his body, it was already dry. She fetched another sheet from the linen closet in the hall and dunked it in the tub, leaving it dripping to put over the other sheet. If they changed only the top one, propriety would be maintained. Dawn was pinking the sky when Mr. Baxter said he needed to leave to do chores at home. That's all right. There are enough of us to care for him. Do you have a telephone in case we need to call you?
No, but I will come back.
Get some sleep first.
He shrugged, squeezed his son's shoulder, and headed out the door, fighting to keep Astrid from seeing his tears. Pastor Solberg brought in a wet sheet.
Any improvement?
No, but I don't think he's any worse.
Mutterings from the patient drew her back to his side. He's been delirious off and on. Mrs. Baxter entered, tying the ends of her headscarf at the base of her neck as she came.
My husband?
Left to do chores just a few minutes ago, Astrid said, speaking slowly and clearly.
Ah, chores.
She nodded her understanding.
We are keeping your son wrapped in cold sheets to keep his fever down.
Astrid pointed at the sheets.
Looks like we are through the worst here, so I'll be on my way. Can I bring you anything?
Pastor Solberg stopped at the doorway.
Thank you, Pastor.
Call me if you need me.
I will.
A bit later, Thelma brought in a breakfast tray for Mrs. Baxter. I have yours ready in the dining room, she told Astrid. Doctor and the mister are eating now.
Astrid nodded.
I just changed the sheets again, and Mrs. Baxter helped me, so now she knows what to do. She turned to the woman.
You eat now and drink your coffee. I will come back later.
Astrid raised the bell.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.